everyone's ready, I think we'll take it away with a little bit.
Is this working okay? Can you hear me all right? Yeah? Okay. Behold my dispatch box. The table's not raising, so here we are, but I like it. So it's a real honor for me to be here with you today, and thank you to the organizers for putting the event together, and thank you to all of you for joining us here and online. So my goal here is to basically briefly describe what degrowth is and why it's needed, and how, more importantly, it should be understood as an element within a broader struggle for socialist and anti-imperialist transformation, rather than as a movement in and of itself. Okay? So the first thing to understand is that the ecological crisis is being driven overwhelmingly by high-income countries in the global north. They have extremely high levels of excess resource use, overshooting sustainable thresholds by a factor of four, driving massive ecosystem damage all around the world. And they're also the main drivers of climate breakdown, responsible for around 90% of all carbon emissions, excess carbon emissions, in excess of the safe planetary boundary. By contrast, the entire global south, right, so all of Asia, Africa, and Latin America, are together responsible for only about 10% of excess emissions. We need to get serious about confronting the brutal reality of climate inequality, and it's from that position that this discourse emerges. And this is not just an ecological problem, it's a justice problem too. The high levels of consumption in the global north rely on appropriating massive quantities of labor, land, and material resources from the global south. According to several recent studies, about half of all consumption in rich nations is net appropriated from the south through imperialist dynamics of unequal exchange. This drains the south of resources that could be used for human development and technological advancement. It produces mass deprivation, and it means that the social and ecological costs of growth in the core are externalized to vulnerable communities in the periphery. This arrangement, I'm sure you'll agree, is wildly destructive and unjust and must be addressed. Now, this brings us to a paradox. The global north has extremely high levels of energy and material use, right? Vastly overshooting planetary boundaries. And yet, it nonetheless still fails to meet many basic human needs. In the US, one of the richest countries in the world, half the population cannot afford healthcare, and 25% live in substandard housing. In the UK, more than 4 million children live in poverty, and you can see the misery on our streets when you walk around. In other words, our economic system fails not just in ecological terms, but in social terms too. This is not just an ecological crisis, but a social crisis. Why is this? What explains this extraordinary paradox that we see in rich countries? The key thing is to understand that these are structural effects of the capitalist economic system. Now, when people hear the word capitalism, they often think of things like businesses and markets and trade. But these things were, of course, around for thousands of years before capitalism and are innocent enough on their own. In reality, the key defining feature of capitalism that we have to pay attention to is that it is fundamentally undemocratic, right? So yes, of course. Obviously, many of us live in democratic political systems where we get to elect our public officials from time to time, even if those systems are obviously inadequate and corrupt. But when it comes to the economic system, the system of production, not even a pretense of democracy exists. Production is controlled overwhelmingly by capital. The major financial firms, the large commercial banks, large corporations, and the 1% who own the majority of investable assets. They are the ones who determine what we produce, how our collective labor and resources will be used, and how the yields of our production will be distributed. And for capital, the purpose of production, right, the purpose of mobilizing our labor and our resources is not to meet human needs or to achieve social progress. Rather, it is to maximize and accumulate profit. That is the overriding objective. So we get perverse forms of production as a result. Massive overproduction of things like SUVs and fast fashion and industrial beef and cruise ships, advertising and weapons, because these things are highly profitable to capital. But we get chronic underproduction of obviously necessary things like public transit, affordable housing, nutritious food, and regenerative agriculture, because these things are much less profitable to capital or not profitable at all. In fact, it is precisely this dynamic that explains why we are moving so slowly in terms of the energy transition. In most cases, renewables are cheaper than fossil fuels, but they also have lower profit margins because they're less conducive to monopoly power. So we're in this horrible nightmare where investment keeps flowing to oil and gas and fracking even as the world burns, because that is rational from the perspective of capital. Now, over the past decade, there have been several countries, including the UK, that have reduced their emissions while continuing to increase their GDP. And every now and then, and then we get media reports about how this is evidence of green growth, right? Everything's going to be fine. But remember, when it comes to climate mitigation, it's not just any amount of mitigation that matters. What matters is speed. We need to reduce emissions fast enough to get to zero by 2050, okay? For high-income countries, this is extremely challenging because they have very high levels of energy use, and high energy use makes sufficiently rapid decarbonization very difficult to achieve, okay? Right now, there is no high-income country that is on track to meet their Paris climate obligations, not even close. At existing rates of mitigation, even the best performers will take, on average, more than 200 years to cut emissions to zero, right? And they'll burn their fair share of the remaining carbon budget 27 times over. There is nothing green about this. It is a recipe for disaster. Much faster mitigation is needed. So here's the reality. If we want to decarbonize fast enough to meet the Paris Agreement goals, not only do we need more investment in renewable energy, but also rich countries need to reduce total energy use. The less energy we use, the faster we can decarbonize. Now, of course, some of this can be achieved through efficiency improvements. We should absolutely embrace the power of technological change and invest in more of it. But we also know empirically that this is not enough in and of itself. Scientists are clear that what we also need is to scale down or degrow less necessary forms of production in order to reduce excess energy use directly. The value of doing this is obvious to any sane observer. Should we be producing things like SUVs, mansions, and fast fashion in the middle of an ecological emergency? The answer is clearly no. There are huge chunks of our economy that are destructive and totally unnecessary for human well-being, you know, mobilized primarily around capital accumulation, and should be scaled down. I want to get this point across loud and clear. If we want to achieve our climate goals, this has to be on the table. Now, in a few minutes, I'll describe how this can be done in practical terms within a broader eco-socialist framework. But first, I want to deal with a few problems. Obviously, degrowth ideas are rejected outright by capitalists. Fair enough. The reason is because, as Marx pointed out, capitalism requires perpetually increasing aggregate production in order to ensure the conditions for perpetual accumulation. But degrowth is also rejected by a vocal group of left growthists. They argue that socialism will unshackle the productive forces, and we should ensure even faster rates of growth under socialism with ever-rising GDP. And this can be reconciled with ecology because technological innovation will be unleashed and enable us to fix the problem. According to this vision, socialism means SUVs and mansions and cruise ships for all. Oh, I didn't realize you disagree to that. Now, let me say, I agree that socialism can unshackle production and innovation. With democratic control over production, we can mobilize innovation around what is most necessary rather than around what is most profitable, and therefore accelerate progress toward ecological goals. I am a strong techno-optimist in this sense. But I'm also a scientist, and I know that we cannot just rely on magical thinking here. Socialism must be grounded in material reality, or it is not socialism at all. And it just so happens that there has been a lot of empirical research on this. There are many green growth scenarios in the published literature, and here's what they show. What they show is that even extremely rapid technological innovation is not enough. To maintain high energy use in the global north, while reconciling this with the Paris objectives, they're forced to do two things. First, they suppress energy use in the global south. This is clearly immoral, unjust, and clearly unacceptable for any self-respecting socialist. Second, they rely on massive negative emissions schemes. And to do this, to make this work, they appropriate massive quantities of land for biofuel plantations, up to 3 times the size of India. Of course, this dramatically exacerbates biodiversity loss, water depletion, and food crises. And the majority of this land, by the way, is appropriated from the global south. This approach is ecologically incoherent and socially unjust. Now, of course, we need some negative emissions, but to imagine this itself is going to solve the problem is fantasy. Now, this highlights a major issue with the left growthist position. It has zero analysis of imperialism. Remember, the high levels of consumption in the core are only possible because of appropriation from the periphery. Without imperialism, consumption in the core would decline by roughly 50%. If we wanted to compensate for this, we would have to double our domestic resource extraction and double our working time. Socialists have to decide whether this is a future they actually want to embrace, right? Because here's the real rub. Left growthists say that they want more GDP growth. But why? GDP is an absolutely terrible indicator from a socialist perspective. It's a metric of aggregate production measured in market prices. Okay? So $1 million worth of tear gas is valued exactly the same as $1 million worth of healthcare and affordable housing. Clearly, when it comes to social progress, one of these is more important than the other, right? It's not aggregate production that matters, but the specific goods and services that are necessary for human well-being. In Marx's terms, what we need is use value, not exchange values. The left growthist obsession with increasing GDP is an effect of capitalist ideology, and we need to put it behind us. Now, some say that there's no way that socialists or trade unions will ever accept these ideas, but I can tell you this is not the case. Earlier this year, representatives of the Spanish Communist Party and left-wing trade unions in Spain officially adopted core degrowth arguments and policies. I was there. Over and over again, people told me that it's just obvious that socialists should take this position. The socialist objective is to achieve democratic control over finance and production and organize it around well-being and ecology. Okay? Clearly, this will require increasing certain forms of production to achieve social and ecological goals, right? While decreasing others, not only because they are destructive, but also because they are a huge waste of labor, which is something socialists care about. So the power of a degrowth approach is that it can liberate labor and productive capacities and enable us to achieve social and ecological goals more quickly. Factories that are presently producing SUVs can produce high-speed trains instead. Engineers that are working on advertising algorithms can innovate green technologies instead. Materials that are presently being used to build casinos and mansions can be used to build affordable housing and public services instead. Degrowth can enable us to accelerate social and ecological development. Right, so how can this be done in practical terms? It's quite simple. Two words, credit guidance. Simply, credit guidance. Simply impose rules on commercial banks to limit credit flows to problem sectors, right? Credit guidance can be used, for example, to scale down fossil fuels on a binding annual schedule, cut off investment in that sector, okay? But it can also be used to reduce other damaging forms of production. And you can use the very same tool, credit guidance, to redirect investment instead to socially and ecologically beneficial forms of production. This is a basic tool of industrial policy, and we must embrace it for green transition. Okay, but let's say that we agree to scale down destructive industries, right? Great, but what about jobs? If this exacerbates unemployment and worsens the economic insecurity that so many people already suffer under capitalism, clearly no one will accept it, and nor should they. But fortunately, there's a straightforward solution that ecological economists propose, and that boils down to two specific social policies. Okay? The first is a public job guarantee. Establish a mechanism such that anyone who wants to can train to participate in the most important public works of our generation with workplace democracy and dignified living wages, building renewable energy capacity, expanding public transit, insulating homes, restoring ecosystems. There's a tremendous amount of work to be done for eco-social transformation, and we can no longer just wait around for capital to decide that it is worth doing. We can and must do it directly, and the public job guarantee is the mechanism for this. Second, universal public services. And here I mean not only healthcare and education, but also housing, public transit, clean energy, water, internet, childcare, recreational facilities, nutritious food. We need to mobilize our productive forces to ensure everyone has access to the core goods and services that are necessary for well-being at a high quality, regardless of fluctuations in aggregate output. What this does is it stabilizes the economy and it de-links well-being from growth. Now think about the power of this approach. It abolishes unemployment. It abolishes economic insecurity. And it means we can pursue radical ecological policy without worrying about anyone getting hurt. This is how you break through people's sense of fear and uncertainty about ecological policy. And keep in mind that these policies are extremely popular, right? A public job guarantee, living wages, universal services, an economy that is organized around well-being and ecology rather than around capital accumulation. Survey after survey shows massive public support for these ideas. And official citizens' assemblies, which are democratic processes in several European countries, have called for precisely this kind of transition. A political platform along these lines will win elections. Okay. But I know what every Starmerite is presently thinking. This all sounds great, but how do we pay for it? The conventional assumption is that first we need to grow private production, okay, and then tax the revenues from that in order to fund public production. But this view is incorrect. Private corporations do not produce money. They produce things, and it makes no sense to say that we need to produce more unnecessary things, like private jets and SUVs, in order to produce more necessary things, like renewable energy and public transit. It's a totally nonsensical proposition. Corporations do not produce money. The government does. But under capitalism, the power of money creation is mostly franchised to commercial banks, which create money when they issue credit. Okay? Now here's the key thing to understand about money. Money represents commands over production. Whoever issues currency can mobilize production to do whatever they want. Right now, this extraordinary power is vested in commercial banks, and they use it to produce whatever is most profitable to capital, rather than what is most necessary for humanity. But we can and we must take this power back. We can democratize the power of money. Any government that has sufficient monetary sovereignty, like Britain does, can issue the national currency to mobilize production to do anything that we need, totally irrespective of whether or not it is profitable. This is called public finance. And we can use this power to solve our ecological and social crises more or less immediately. We can establish a public job guarantee. We can build universal services. We can insulate homes. We can innovate efficient technology, all of it. And we can do it now. There's no obstacle to this. As Keynes put it, anything we can actually do, we can afford. Now, of course, our ability to do this is limited by the productive capacity of the economy, the national stock of labor and resources and factories. If all of this new public activity exceeds the productive capacity of the economy, it could drive inflation. Okay? But this problem is solved precisely by the fact that with degrowth, we are simultaneously reducing unnecessary production elsewhere in the economy. Right? So as you increase production, in some sectors you reduce in others. And of course, we must also take steps to cut the purchasing power of the rich with progressive taxation to reduce their demands on the productive base. What this approach does is it shifts labor and resources away from servicing the interests of capital accumulation and toward achieving socially and ecologically necessary objectives. This is how you democratize the economy. This is how you do socialism in the 21st century. Think about it this way. The ecological crisis, like the social crisis, is 100% a problem of the production system. That's it. Under capitalism, we suffer from a massive misallocation of production. Too much of some things and not enough of other things. Why? Because capitalism is undemocratic. So what is the antidote to this problem? Economic democracy. Democratize finance. Democratize the public services. Democratize businesses. We know empirically that when people have democratic control over production, they focus on what is required for welfare and ecology. It's as simple as that. People already know what to do. Democracy is the antidote to a socially and ecologically destructive economy. Now, I've argued that this approach can be popular. If you can credibly promise to deliver economic security, real improvements in well-being, and real progress towards stopping climate breakdown, you will win. You will cut through the cynicism and the despair, and you will win. But clearly, this requires a class struggle against those who benefit so prodigiously from the status quo. And it seems abundantly clear to me that if we are to succeed in doing this, we need to build a political vehicle that is capable of it, a vehicle that can integrate environmentalists and students and labor movements and other progressive political forces to achieve these mutually beneficial objectives. So let me close by saying this. The Starmer Labor Party puts us in a very dangerous position. With their present policies, they will clearly fail to resolve the social and ecological contradictions that plague this broken country. And as the center fails, the fascists will rise, unless there is a popular left alternative that offers a clear diagnosis of the problem and a compelling vision for the future and a pathway for how to get there. That is what we need to build, and we need to start now. Thank you.
Thanks, comrades, and thanks very much to Jason. I want to start by thanking Jason for coming to this Marxism Festival. And one of the reasons for that, I think, is because his book, Less is More, is a really important book. I think it's a very important contribution for everyone who is engaged in a radical critique of capitalism and a radical critique of the way capitalism destroys human life and the environment. And indeed, if you go to any bookshop in the country, there will be a plethora of books on with degrowth in the title. Jason's, I think, goes the furthest in terms of its anti-capitalist critique and its vision for a post-capitalist society. I would highly recommend people read it. They discuss it and debate it. I got my well-thumbed copy signed by Jason a few minutes ago, and you can do the same at the stall at the end. I think it's important that we have books like Less is More and the sort of critique of capitalism that Jason has outlined, because we cannot underestimate the extraordinary level of crisis that we are facing around the world from environmental degradation. And I think we must constantly insist that it's capitalism that is driving that degradation. Constantly say that. Make that the key part of our argument. It's the intersection between environmental crisis and all the fissures and fractures of capitalist society, class in particular, but race, gender, nation states and so on, that combine to make sure that there's no such thing anymore as a natural disaster. These are all social disasters, made worse, driven by capitalism and made worse by the nature of capitalism. I think it was absolutely right last week that the Prime Minister of St. Vincent and the Grenadines in the Caribbean, Ralph Gonsalves, said, as his country waited for Hurricane Beryl barreling down upon it, from the major emitters of greenhouse gases, those who've contributed the most to global warming, you get a lot of talking, but you're not seeing a lot of action, as in making money available to small state and small island, developing states and other vulnerable countries. And the consequences are there on the TV screens constantly, not just, of course, in the Caribbean, but in the appalling reality of Asia recently, with a massive, massive heat wave, killing hundreds and hundreds of people, and forcing people to have to work and live in conditions that are almost unbearable and inhospitable to human life. And I think the task of radicals thus is threefold. I think we have to firstly and foremost fight for the most aid and assistance for those suffering in the here and now. And I think this should go without saying, but actually, if you think about some of the policies, as Jason has indicated, from this Starmer government, there's no guarantee that there'll be money made available for people who are suffering from floods or disasters or firestorms or heat waves. And we have to fight to make sure that the climate crisis that is caused by the development of the global north doesn't leave those people alone. The second thing we must do, of course, as Jason again has said, is to fight for the biggest possible change in the here and now that can reduce the impact of future global warming. The most reforms that we can get to reduce energy use, to switch to renewable energy, efficiency savings, and all those things, those must be things that we fight for, not just in terms of random demands, but concrete action in the here and now. I think that the campaign against climate change bears our Million Climate Jobs report has bears many similarities to some of the things that Jason has talked about. And of course, thirdly, and flowing from these two, and not in, indeed in separate in any way, is then the struggle for a system that relates to the natural world in a radically different way, that fights for a revolutionary change and for an end to capitalism's destruction. And I think this discussion over degrowth goes to the heart of all three of those aspects. How can we fight for those things in the here and now? What demands can we place on our governments? What can our trade union movement and the left and the environmental movement demand and fight for today? Now, I suppose slightly in a kind of little dialectical trick here, I'm actually not going to talk about degrowth very much now. I'm going to talk about growth. Because actually, one of the interesting and one of the things that makes me most enthusiastic about books like Jason's is the way that Marx's criticism of capitalism's imperative to grow, its accumulation for the sake of accumulation, as Marx writes, has become actually almost second nature to whole sections of the environmental movement. I mean, indeed, if you want a very good summary of what Marx said about growth, Jason's book is a good starting place. I think it's really heartening to see that. Marx, and of course us today, we argue that growth isn't a veneer to capitalism. It isn't a sort of superficial aspect or even an ideological thing on the part of the capitalism and the capitalists. It's how the system functions. Well, really, it's how the system would function if the bourgeoisie got its way and allowed it. Because capitalism doesn't always grow. Sometimes it stagnates and shrinks. But that's not what the capitalists want. The capitalists do want growth and so on. And Marx wasn't the first person to talk about growth. In my article in the current International Socialism Journal on degrowth, I explore some of the sort of predecessors in classical economics about growth. You know, people like Adam Smith, who talked about accumulation and talked about growth. But what Marx does is he places his understanding of growth in the context of how capitalism functions on a day-to-day basis. And he argues, I think, very, very eloquently that the capitalist experiences, the individual capitalist, the individual boss of a corporation or CEO or board members, what they experience capitalism as is as a compulsion to grow, that they have to behave like this, because if they don't behave like this, they risk losing everything. And Marx locates this in the two great divisions in capitalist societies. And the first of these divisions is the one that we all experience on a day-to-day basis when we go to work. It's that forcing of that exploitative relationship between the boss and the worker, that exploitative relationship, which means that the boss makes you work as hard as he can get work out of you to maximize the amount of profits he makes from you. And ultimately, their growth is based on the fact that we create more value with our labour on a daily basis than they pay us in wages. It's a very, very simple fact. But the fact is we as a working class collectively, and we often as workers individually, are having that dynamic. We create more surplus value than they pay us in wages. And that is the source of their profits, but crucially, it's the source of the wealth that they reinvest to expand the economy and to push them forward. And they have to do that because of the second great division in capitalist society, the one that Marx talked about, this warring band of brothers, as he called them, the division between the capitalists themselves. The capitalists who are united when it comes to the threat from the working class, but who are constantly fighting and sniping at each other in their attempts to stay ahead. That competition between those bosses forces the capitalists as individuals or as heads of particular companies and multinationals to push and expand outwards, because without that ability to grow, they risk falling behind, going bust and losing out and losing on everything. So for people like Marx, growth isn't something simply about capital getting bigger or companies getting bigger. Sometimes there's a sort of simplistic explanation to say it's all, they just want a little bit more, they want an extra car or an extra bit of luxury. And of course that is an element to how they behave. But there's also that endless drive to expand so they can stay ahead of the game. Marx puts it, the process, really nicely in Capital. He says, accumulate, accumulate, that's Moses and the prophets. That's a little dialectical joke there from Marx, which I always like. Save, save, he says. Reconvert the greatest possible portion of surplus value into capital. Accumulate for the sake of accumulation. Production for the sake of production. That's the formula in which classical economics expresses the historical mission of the bourgeoisie. I really like it because it could be capitalism today, you know, that constant pushing outwards, no matter what the consequences, no matter what else happens. What I want to introduce then into this discussion is another factor which Marx is very, very keenly aware of, because growth is inherent to capitalism, but so is class struggle. Because capitalism is an exploitative system, people are constantly forced to resist it. Forced to resist it for better wages, for a better conditions of living, forced to resist what it's doing to their communities, to their nation, and so on, and so forth. And that's important in this discussion, because I would argue that it's the balance of class forces, it's the ability of workers to fight, and the confidence with which they fight, that actually determines how much of the wealth that they create is received by them. If there was no class struggle, as there essentially hasn't been on a very successful scale for the last three decades, essentially most of the benefits from growth would be concentrated in the hands of the rich. Indeed, that's what you've seen over the last two or three decades. If there's class struggle, workers can win a bit more. They can win better wages, better conditions, more time off, etc. But actually, that's not been the reality of the last few years, and the last few decades even. And that's something we have to suffer and survive with. It has other consequences that I'll come on to in a moment. But one thing that is important about that is it gives a lie to an argument about growth. You hear it from the right all the time. Liz Truss, if anyone remembers Liz Truss, in a very brief period of her premiership, made this big thing about growing the economy to create a bigger pie. It's always the analogy they use. A bigger pie, and we'll all benefit from it. But actually, the fact that growth over the last three decades demonstrate that not everybody does benefit. Actually, growth inherently, unless working people are fighting, unless there's successful class struggle, most of the wealth goes to the people who are all already wealthy. Now, Liz Truss says it. One of the problems, I think, is that actually the trade union leaders and people like Keir Starmer also say it. And we have to reject it, because unless there's struggle, it's not going to be automatic that we will also benefit from the growth that the capitalists tell us is so good for us and the world and everybody in it. And that's why I want to emphasise that centrality of workers and class struggle to this conundrum of how we deal with all these situations. Now, the American Marxist John Bellamy Foster, who spoke actually in this room a few years ago at Marxism, he made the point that the accumulation of capital is simultaneously the accumulation of catastrophe. And I think that's a really pithy, nice little statement of what capitalism's reality is like. And degrowth, I think, is thus a response to that reality, to the fact that catastrophe is the consequence of everyone of capitalism's day-to-day behaviour. And I'm going to slightly embarrass Jason by quoting a couple of quotes from his book. Degrowth, Jason writes, is the planned reduction of excess energy and resource use to bring the economy back into balance with the living world in a safe and just and equitable way. And I think that's an absolutely brilliant thing to say. And I think it's exactly how I would envisage a socialist society relating to the economy and to the environment. And Jason has outlined what that might mean concretely in terms of cars and so on. And of course, we also have to recognise that we do want some things to grow. I mean, I'd like more swimming pools, more public libraries, etc., etc. I'm sure everyone else has got their example. I think the point that's being made today is that that sort of growth can happen in a rationally planned and organised society if we were allowed to, but it cannot happen in the irrational way that capitalism behaves. But the key thing, really, and I suppose this is the last final bit of my meeting today, is how do we get there? Because here I think we have to understand that the process of struggling in the here and now has to become both a fight for real change in our day-to-day lives, real conditions of workers and wages and the rest of it, and a fight for real reforms that can make a difference in terms of our economy's impact upon the natural world. But it also has to be directed and push in a direction that can begin to challenge the fundamental realities of capitalism. And Jason, again, to embarrass you, here's how Jason writes about it in Less is More, and I think it's an important, Jason makes a very important point. Degrowth scholarship embraces technological change and efficiency improvements to the extent that these are empirically feasible, ecologically coherent, and socially just. But it also recognises that this alone will not be enough. Economic and social transformations are also necessary, including a transition out of capitalism. The debate is not primarily about technology, but about science, justice, and the structure of the economic system. Here again, I think we have to emphasise a point, that the problem isn't technology. It isn't that there's a wrong type of technology or the technology doesn't exist. You do hear this at times. If only we had the right form of carbon capture, if only we had the right things that we could pump into the atmosphere to block the sunlight and so on. That's not the problem. The problem is actually we live in a society whose political structures arising from the desire constantly to accumulate capital block those technologies being used in the interests of reducing emissions or fighting for a sustainable economy, which is why Jason and I hope for me myself are emphasising that we need a transition out of capitalism. And I do think that's important, and I do want to emphasise, I mean, part of the problem discussing degrowth, and me and Jason have exchanged emails about this, is actually not everyone agrees, not everyone who labels themselves a degrowther may necessarily agree with all of these points. Not everyone who is a degrowther necessarily sees capitalism as the problem. I want to emphasise that I think our analysis of capitalism's imperative and drive to growth means that you cannot have a green capitalism, you cannot have a sustainable capitalism, you cannot have a capitalism that can benefit people and the environment. Now, there are some criticisms of this approach. I often hear when I talk about the environment and I do meetings on these sort of topics and in left meetings and socialist meetings and trade union branches and so on, you hear a sort of crude argument that says that degrowth is another form of austerity. It's just about attacking the workers. Actually, this is actually comes from the right and has kind of embedded itself a bit in some left and trade union thinkers. I think we have to reject this approach. Almost every degrowther I've ever read actually doesn't believe that degrowth is about austerity. But it is natural that people who have seen their lives cut and attacked and their public services decimated can hear the words growth and degrowth and fear the worst. I think it's particularly for perhaps a slightly different reason an issue in the global south. And here I think as activists primarily in the global north and in Europe, we have to think about how the articulation of our arguments can be interpreted and understood in the global south. And I would say, and I think Jason would almost certainly agree with me here, that we have to argue that the reason that the global south is impoverished and under-resourced and suffering primarily at hands of global warming and so on, is because of historic structures of imperialism that have arisen out of the nature of capitalism that have deliberately robbed and underdeveloped the global south. And that means, I think, that we have to have a twin-handed approach to those in the global south who want to see their economies and their lives improved and developed. We cannot, for instance, say to a worker in Sudan or somebody on the streets currently in Kenya, you cannot have the things you are fighting for. I'm absolutely honest about that. What our job is to do is to fight to shatter the relations of capitalism in the global north that are holding back those that develop and that economic problems in the global south. We know that the global south could develop along sustainable and equitable paths. It'll require a challenge to capitalism there and here in the north. But the people who can push that forward and the best position to do that are the peasants and workers of the global south themselves. And they don't need the left in the global north telling them how they should or they shouldn't behave. That said, I think we also have to recognise that there's a resonance with this argument here in the global north. We're here at Marxism. There's been a number of meetings marking the 40th anniversary of the miners' strike, for instance, the great battle between Thatcher's Tory government and one of the most powerful British trade union movements the country has ever seen, and ending with the defeat for the miners. We now know, of course, that the industry they were fighting to defend was tremendously detrimental to the environment and fueling environmental destruction. Was it wrong to support the miners and wish them to win? Of course not. If the miners had won, if the miners had defeated Thatcher, we would have seen a working class that was 100,000 and tens of thousands and more combative and confident and able not just to fight or to defend their jobs or their wages, but able to challenge governments and then go forward and begin to talk about how it could have shaped a new way of relating and organising a society. Because I would argue that when workers fight and win, they begin not just to think about how they can win better wages or better conditions at work, but actually to begin to have a new way of understanding and interpreting the world around them. Jason's absolutely right to talk about the importance of class struggle for this particular reason, because when workers fight, the horizons are opened up and they begin to think that things can be done differently and organised very, very differently. And that, I think, is a revolutionary strategy. It is why in my own book, I wrote about the inequalities of capitalism and the injustices of capitalism, the problem of climate change, but I also wrote about the Paris Commune of 1871, or the Russian Revolution, or the Sudanese Revolution of 2019, or indeed the Egyptian Revolution of 2011, because in all of these struggles, in all of these revolutionary moments, and indeed all of the struggles leading up to them, what you saw is workers beginning to take control of their workplaces, of their communities, of their economies, and indeed their energy supplies. And workers in struggle, I think, are the ones who will be best placed to position and fight for a different way of organising society, and indeed a different way of relating to the natural world. Because my final two points would be this. Firstly, that Marx didn't just write about socialism as a set of economic relations where we'd have more swimming pools, more libraries, or better wages. That was never what socialism was about for Marx. Marx wrote about socialism as being an entirely different relationship to the natural world, where the natural world was not a commodity, where it was something that we were part of and shaping in our constant day-to-day lives, and that our economy under socialism will be geared towards us rationally planning our use of resources and our use of the natural world and our sharing of those resources around the world because of our ability to democratically control our lives. And that's why he saw the revolutionary movement of masses of people coming together, shaping that and fighting for that as a part of that transition. The very final thing I do want to say, though, at this point, is that Marx offered us one final insight, which I think is tremendously important to the story of how we get from where we are to how where we want to be, which is his articulation of a theory of the capitalist state. And I think this is something that is under-theorised, not necessarily by Jason, but certainly by some people in the environmental movement, who kind of see the state as this neutral body that can just be sort of moved around. I think we have to insist that the state is a set of instruments and institutions and armed bodies that exist to protect that system of capital accumulation, and it needs to be destroyed. And the only force that can destroy it, I think, is the organised working class and the peasantry of the global south and the global north, fighting not just for a bigger slice of a pie, but fighting for a different way of organising the baking, if you like. Is that a really mixed metaphor? It is. But I think fighting for a different way of organising a society in the interests of everyone, by everyone. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Sky, and thank you to all of you. I really enjoyed your contributions. You should be up here speaking, actually. I'll try to be as brief as I can and address everything that has been said, or most things. The first has to do with class inequalities and climate change. I 100% agree. Some research from last year finds that millionaires alone are on track to burn through 72% of the remaining carbon budget for 1.5 degrees, right? I mean, this is, climate change is class war. and this makes it very clear. However, and by the way, there's a guy in the audience called Max Lawson who works on this, and he's brilliant, and you should look up his work from Oxfam. But in addition to thinking about just consumption emissions of the ruling class and the rich and so on, it's also important to pay attention not just to what they're consuming, but how they control investment, which is the main problem, right? You might find that a working class person in the US has quite high emissions on a personal basis. But that is not the grounds on which you should judge the class dynamics of climate change, right? What matters is the broader provisioning systems in the economy, right? Like how the transit system works, how the healthcare system works, how the agricultural system works, which is not in the hands of any individual person, right? Who's it in the hands of? It's in the hands of capital. It's in the hands of the rich who control investments, right? So when you think about it this way, then of course the ruling class is 100% responsible for the problem. Because without capitalist control of investment, we would have solved the problem long ago. To the question about money, I'm definitely not talking about governments buying bonds and then being stuck in a system of having to pay back rising interest rates, et cetera, et cetera. I'm talking about public finance in the true sense, where governments understand and accept their power as currency issuers, right? In lieu of going into this in detail, I urge you to have a look at the documentary Finding the Money, which is based largely on Stephanie Kelton's work, who has, I think, been revolutionary in changing public understandings of this. To the question of who implements all of this, for me, I'm calling for two things. Democratic control over finance, where democratically we control finance towards investments in what we know to be socially and ecologically necessary, withdrawing finance from what is destructive and unnecessary. So finance in alignment with democratically ratified objectives. The second thing is outside of the public sector, democratic firms, where, as the comrade mentioned, workers can make decisions about increasing production to meet specific community and broader national needs, or reducing production of less necessary things, even closing up a business entirely, right, with no loss to their livelihood or economic security, because that's taken care of by universal public services and the job guarantee, et cetera, right? So I think that's crucial. A brief thing here about growth imperatives. I agree with everything Martin said about how this is not just like, growth is not just kind of a phenomenon in and of itself, it's an epiphenomenon of capital accumulation. So we have to pay attention to the structure of capitalist competition. But also, there are also social growth imperatives. And this is the main one, which is basically, as our technology improves and our labor productivity increases, then workers get laid off because it requires less labor to produce any given unit of output, right? And so there's constantly, under capitalism, a constant crisis of unemployment, okay? People lose their jobs and their houses, and they end up on the street. It's a wild system, actually, that we accept this. And so the only way to solve this crisis, according to our ruling classes, is more growth. Stimulate more private production. Doesn't matter of what, anything will do, as long as it generates jobs. For what? For capital accumulation, right? It's insane. And this is a constant pressure. And of course, growth never solves the problem. We grow every year and still we have unemployment. Okay? It's a completely irrational approach. Every time a politician gets up and says, we have unemployment, we need more growth, this is absolute bullshit. It's absolute bullshit. You don't solve the crisis that way. You solve it with a public job guarantee and with living wages. And to the extent that you don't require as much labor to deliver what the society needs, then you shorten the working week and share necessary labor more evenly, taking the yields in the form of leisure, right? It's not difficult to deal with. Now, let me talk about trade unions briefly. Trade unions are in a bad spot because they often end up having to line up behind capital in demanding more growth for the sake of protecting their job security and wages. And you can't blame them for this, right? I've been part of trade unions my entire life, and I know how this logic works. But we must think beyond this, and I urge all of you who are part of unions to have this conversation. We have to think beyond our specific shop floor battles. We have to think about solving this problem at a broader scale. Again, lining up behind a strong movement and demand for a job guarantee and living wages and universal services. This is how it has to be done. I want to address briefly the pie metaphor. It's powerful because it seeps into our mind, right? The idea that we're fighting about a fair distribution of the existing pie. But that's really not what we have to be about here, right? It's not just a distribution of the pie, but a different pie altogether. Because GDP measures anything in the pie, right? It could be a pie full of toxic sludge. And that's not what we want. We want a pie full of public health care and affordable housing and high-quality public transit, right? It doesn't help us if we're growing a pie full of SUVs and private jets, because we don't benefit from those things. So I'm summing up now. So let me briefly say something about the word degrowth, because I feel that I've got to address this before I leave. I understand how this lands problematically with people, especially people who are suffering. I think that it is good for analysis. We need it to sharpen our analysis of what is required in the economy. We need it to hone our understanding of what policies we need. But ultimately, the word does not matter. And I do not think that anyone needs to be up at podiums in the public at the platform using the word degrowth. I really don't. What matters is the policies. What matters is the politics. And then finally, with the question of the Global South, we have to understand this key fact. The vast majority of people in the global south underconsume. They underconsume energy and they underconsume material resources. They need a dramatic increase in their consumption of materials and energy in order to meet human needs at a high standard, right? Now, that should never just be, of course, about increasing production in an aggregate way, regardless of what we're actually producing. And for evidence here, let me point to a recent meeting I had, which was very surreal, with the president of Cuba, who immediately told me, when he was told that I'd written a book about growth, he said, "You need to understand something, comrade. Growth is a capitalist ideology. what matters for the sake of for developments is not to increase aggregate production as measured by market prices, but to increase what is necessary for human well-being and social progress. That is what development should always be about. If that requires an increase in aggregate production, fine, right? But that should never be the objective. And so this is not about us deciding how the Global South should grow. There's a rich tradition of socialist thought and anti-colonial thought in the Global South that deals with this question directly, and we are the heirs of that tradition. We are the heirs of that tradition. So I think that's the key thing to point to here. Of course, in the Global South, what is ultimately required is economic liberation. And, right, the South has to control their own means of production in order to achieve ecological transition. And the role of the left in the Global North is to ensure that when they make attempts at economic liberation, we are there to support them. We are there to push back against the demonization that the media will absolutely inflict on them and support their struggle for liberation. Thank you.
I want to start by the question of ideology, because I argued, and I think Jason just did, that the question of growth in terms of capitalism isn't a ideological thing. It's not like those old socialists used to say, you know, if we just convince enough of the capitalists to behave in a nice way, it'll all be all right. When growth is intrinsic and the logic of growth arises out of the structures and nature of capitalism. But that's not to say that growth isn't ideological. Actually, it's incredibly ideological. There is a reason that the predominant measure of growth, the use of the gross domestic product, the GDP, is structured in the way it is. The original people, the economists who came up with that, didn't want to include in GDP, for instance, things like the arms industry, because they wanted it to be a measure of social wealth. But actually, the World Bank and the rest of them didn't want that. They wanted GDP to be a measure of how well capitalism was doing. And so if you think about how capitalism is and all those petty horrors of capitalism, it's all encapsulated in how they measure GDP. For instance, growth can arise out of a water company dumping sewage into your local river. Why? Because it costs money to clean it up. And that's good, because somebody's spending money and somebody's benefiting from that and someone's making profit. It's, you know, selling arms to Israel is good for growth. The things that don't make growth actually illuminate what actually capitalism doesn't care about and what isn't interested in. You know, women looking after children at home, that's not part of growth at all. You know, I don't know, me doing DIY at home doesn't figure on growth, even though I'm doing labour and work. All those things that we hold dear and we care about and are important to us actually don't measure because of how the capitalists understand the world that they're living in. And that arises, I would argue, out of the nature of capitalism itself. And it also then makes itself into that, impinges and becomes part of how they relate to the natural world. There's a wonderful quote, which I have often used at meetings before. I'm sure you've heard it. It's in my book. From Marx's Grundrisse, where he talks about how under capitalism, for the first time, nature becomes a commodity, something they can buy and sell. And they have to enforce this worldview on the rest of the world as capitalism expands by smashing the old social relations, smashing up indigenous ideas and communities and the rest of it, because otherwise it doesn't make sense. Why should we be able to buy and sell trees and rivers and all the rest of it? It doesn't make any sense at all. But in terms of the capitalists, it makes a lot of sense. And it arrives at its highest point in how they think they're going to solve it. Because they think they're going to solve climate change by doing the same processes, by finding new ways of accumulating capital and accumulating wealth. Carbon trading schemes, taxations, and all these fantastical ideas that you hear uttered over and over again at different COP conferences by different sort of World Bank economists, they're not really about reducing emissions. They're about driving growth and capital accumulation. And actually, the mainstream politicians of left and right have got nothing else to offer. If you read the party manifestos from cover to cover, I'm sure you all did, didn't you? The Liberal Democrats mentioned growth 13 times, and the Tories mentioned it 18 times in their manifesto, and the Labour Party mentions it 48 times. Now, I'm sure they would have justifications for that. For me, that tells you that actually the only solution they see, and you see it already in the practice of Starmer, is that they're going to deliver solutions by trying to expand that pie. That mythical pioneer isn't going to work. And as Jason so eloquently pointed out, waiting in the wings are the people who are going to say, actually, that's the problem. See, why is it that Farage makes all the time going on and attacking net zero? It's not actually because he cares about net zero. It's a meaningless conflict, you know. But for him, it's this sort of indicator, a message he's sending to large numbers of people about how the political establishment is. And we have to be very, very aware of this. 30 different reform candidates made public statements in the run-up to the election about how they didn't believe in global warming. They did that not because actually they thought it would get them elected, but actually they're trying to send a message about how the establishment views the world and how people are being let down by that. And we have, as a movement, to be alert to this, which means that we have to do two things. We have to fight very much for real change, radical change, things that can benefit ordinary people, at the same time as fighting the right, challenging their lies and their hysteria and their racism, putting climate justice and anti-racism and refugee solidarity at the heart, not just of the work of the left, but of the work of trade unions and the work of the environmental movement. And that, I think, is crucially important, because I think what we have to do is we have to provide an alternative. We have to provide a different vision of how things are going to be. We have to expose the lies of the capitalists from left and right and say, look, they haven't got any answers. They can't solve it. They aren't going to solve it. At the same time as articulating arguments that mean real things to real people, which is why the Million Climate Jobs Report from the Campaign Against Climate Change is one of those really important tools, because it says, look, you can have decent jobs. You can have real jobs. You can have jobs that pay well, are also sustainable and contribute to reducing emissions and building a sustainable government. And when they say, yes, I want one of these jobs, how can I get it? We have to say, well, we have to fight for it. We have to fight for it as workers, as trade unionists, as the left, and so on. But we also have to talk about a vision of something much, much bigger. You see, I talk about revolution in these meetings because I think it's about hope. I think if you're a worker in North America at the moment, or a worker in Britain, or a worker in the global south in particular, it's very, very difficult to have hope that things are going to get better. I think we have to say, look, it's not going to be easy, it's not going to be automatic, and it's not going to get handed down on a plate from the new person in 10 Downing Street. It's going to have to be fought for. I think people will have to say, right, well, let's roll up our sleeves, and we have to be the people saying, let's fight now. Let's fight now for better conditions at work. Let's fight now for better wages. Let's fight now for solidarity with refugees. Let's fight now for more action on climate change. Let's fight for all of these things. As we win each one of those, our movement will grow stronger, and our movement will fight for much, much more. And that might mean sometimes that we have to fight for things that aren't actually immediately good for the environment, like those miners 40 years ago. But if we win those, think what we can build in the future. Think of the power our side and the confidence our class will have. Thank you.